proud of his or her heritage or what he or she is following. The minimum link you can have is your identity, my brothers and sisters. Do you know, and I bear witness that I have seen this with my eyes, there are people who have turned to Islam solely because they were treated according to the Islamic teachings of treatment by Muslims who were proud Muslims in terms of identity at a time when these people really needed help and they were non-Muslim. In other words, there are non-Muslims who turned to Islam because they were assisted by Muslims whose identity was manifest. Subhanallah, I know. I have seen with my eyes and I've witnessed. So the question I have for myself and yourselves, sometimes you can spread Islam, my brothers and sisters, just by your identity. Don't you believe you're a good person? I believe I am. I try to be. And I think every one of us here, you try to be a good Muslim, don't you? Well, if you try to be a good Muslim and those who are not Muslim or weak Muslims see you trying to be a good Muslim and they are benefited from it, they will automatically be attracted. But if your identity was not there, they would not even know that you were Muslim. Subhanallah. So sometimes just to identify yourself as a Muslim, no matter who you are and what's happening, you're a Muslim, just identify yourself. Put yourself into the box and say, you know what, I am also one. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. I have seen people who have accepted Islam, had a chance to chat with them, and a few of them have told me through these years that I accepted Islam solely because I was intrigued by this superstar who accepted Islam, and I wanted to know what did he see in this religion that is being so dangerously spoken about across the globe that made him turn to it at a time when it's so difficult. And when I started reading and searching, I found it to be true. And I said, Subhanallah, have you ever spoken to this celebrity? And they say, no, we haven't. But we just saw this happen and we thought if they could turn, who are we? This is the point I'm making. If you are a person who people look up to and you are the one who has a link with the messenger, that link on its own is powerful enough to be beamed across in a way that you might enter paradise not through your deeds but through the deeds of those who did deeds because of you or because of what you beamed. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. May Allah make us strong. This is why we say we try, we read our prayers, we try our best. Sometimes when we have uttered a word of encouragement, or even if you have just, you know, come forth and beamed through your identity, your Islamic teachings, and others have followed it, perhaps the reward of that might be far greater than anything you have done in your own life. Don't underestimate it. Your link with your messenger. We ask the Almighty to strengthen that link. Like I say, and I repeat this because for me, it is a point of strength when I think about it. I tell myself, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, he strived so many years. What happened to him? He was known as a person who was powerful. He was moved after being an enemy of Islam by the recitation of not more than 4 to 5 verses. Why is it that I am not moved? And I've read the entire Quran so many times. Is it the sincerity levels that are wrong? What is wrong? Is it because I don't have a link with my maker and I don't have a link with the messenger whom he sent? And they, as I said, they gave their lives for you. What are you prepared to do? Sometimes we are not prepared to dress appropriately and yet they died for the deen. This is a solid point. They died for the deen. Like I say, nobody's asking you to die for the deen, but by right, we are supposed to be sacrificing to strengthen ourselves to start with, and thereafter to help each other. May the Almighty bless us all. Then comes the crucial question. I'm a human being, and I'm a Muslim, and I believe in the life after death. And I need to prepare for the day I meet my maker, because that is the purpose of creation. Allah has created you in order for you to prepare for the day you will meet him. So he created us and he wants to meet with us, But before the meeting, he's given us a chance to prepare. You know, when you are meeting a dignitary, for example, you're meeting someone, mashallah, of a very high standing, there is a bit of preparation sometimes. You want to present yourself well. You might have something you've taken for them. You might have something, you know, that you would like to prepare. You would like to present yourself in a correct way. What about your maker? Allah has given you an average 60 to 70 years on average to prepare for the day you meet with him. So imagine if I had to pitch up meeting the president or meeting some form of, you know, dignitaries, and I'm in my shorts, I'm half in my PJs, and I'm running, hey, sorry, I'm late. Just picture that for a moment. You know, it would be foolish. Imagine if you had to meet up with the CEO of the company you work for, and, you know, you come about and your hair is somewhere else, you know, talking about perhaps the way you look. You know, you have toothpaste on your cheek, and, you know, a little while later you notice that there's a mark of your wife's lipstick on the other cheek and so on. That would be embarrassing, wouldn't it? It would be very embarrassing. Well, to be honest, that's an example of this world. Some of us might die in a condition, may Allah protect us, where we would be embarrassed to face our Maker. And Allah says, you know what? You just need to seek forgiveness. Turn. Allah is such that whenever you seek forgiveness, He forgives you. I just need to prepare for the day I meet with my Maker. How will I do that? I need to fulfill what He has instructed me to fulfill as best as I can. As best as I can means according to my capacity and capability. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Idha nahaytukum an shay'in fantahu." If I have prohibited you from something, then do not do it. "Wa idha amartukum bi shay'in fa'tu minhu mastata'tum." And if I have instructed you to do something, then do it as best as you can. Do you see the difference between the two? When you're instructed to do something, you do it as best as you can, your ability, your capability. And when you're instructed not to do something, don't find yourself there. No excuse to do that. And if you have fallen, repent. This is why when you look at salah and prayer, you find that the hadith says, صَلِّ قَائِمًا فَإِن لَّمْ تَسْتَطِعْ فَقَاعِدًا فَإِن لَّمْ تَسْتَطِعْ فَعَلَى جَنْبٍ. Read salah standing. If you are unable, then read it sitting. And if you are unable, then read it lying down. So this means I will do it to the best of my ability. That's my ability, my capability. And inshallah, I will try to improve. There is no point in reading it lying down and saying, I'm just tired, you know. I'm tired. No, get up. Allah's given you the ability and capability to stand, to bend properly and so on. Some people cannot bend all the way in ruku'. So you do it as best as you can, subhanallah. That's the power of the deen. Allah knows you're a human. So do whatever you are instructed to do as best as you can. And that will help you prepare for the day you meet your Maker.